Hello everyone, and welcome to my talk, Yeet Lead with a Whispery, Effective Threat Hunting Without Breaking Bank. Let me first start by introducing myself. Who am I? My name is Sebastian Provost. I'm a lead security engineer at a company called Beacon, and I've also experienced with building the security operations function for a financial tech company. In my free time, I like to dabble around with tools and resources related to information security. I like to travel the world, and I like to go to the gym, sometimes after a hard day of work to clear my mind. Now, let me first explain a little bit what my motivation is, what my thought process is for this talk, why I'm doing this talk. So nowadays, at present, we have lots of EDR, MDR, XDR solutions who are seen as the one-stop solution for security. They're seen as the answer for security, especially in endpoints and devices. Because they're seen as the solution, lots of companies, they want to compete. So there are also lots of companies who are presenting their own solution. Some of the more known ones are Falcon from CrowdStrike, Singularity from SentinelOne, you have Carbon Black from VMware, and so on and so on. Because they're seen as the one-stop solution for security, they're sometimes quite expensive, they're quite pricey. But that doesn't bother people, that doesn't bother companies. Because people and companies, they want to stay safe. And they think, oh, it's one-stop solution for security. We'll mind paying for that. But sometimes these solutions, they still miss common techniques and payloads. They still miss some basic items, basic elements that might slip through the nets and that will give a foothold for potentially malicious actors or red teams. Now, my talk is not to say that solutions are bad. No, not at all. They're actually quite good. My talk is just to show how a Whiskery can potentially help the solutions, how a Whiskery can complement those solutions. So basically, to improve security on endpoints and devices, let's make the solutions and Whiskery work next to each other. Let's make them complement each other to keep everyone as secure as possible. So what can you expect from my talk? First, I'll introduce you to a Whiskery. What is it? Who made it? And what are its capabilities? Then I'll go over a few command and control frameworks and the payloads, how to set them up, and what they provide. Why am I doing this? Because some of them I might use a little bit as an example further down the talk as well. When we pass that, I'll also show how you can catch reverse shells. And right before that, I'll also show you how Whiskery can be used to actually catch those command and control frameworks. When all that is done, I'll also show you how you can create alerting pipelines from when an event's happening and Whiskery finds something, all the way to alerting your security operations team so they can intervene whenever it's necessary. Because of course, if something's happening, you want your security operations team to be able to intervene or to see if it's a false positive or not. When all that is done, I'll quickly give a quick strip of what we've seen around the entire talk. Let me first start by introducing to OWASQuery. What is OWASQuery? OWASQuery is an operating system instrumentation framework that mainly supports Windows, macOS, Linux, FreeBSD. It can potentially support other operating systems as well, but you would have to compile themselves. For those, the four I've mentioned, there are pre-built packages that can be downloaded on the official site. Originally, OWASQuery was made by Facebook. It was made by Facebook because they want to have an easier way to have an insight on the overall state of the infrastructure. Nowadays, it's maintained by a separate foundation that started by Facebook and the Linux Foundation together to be able to maintain the growing OWASQuery ecosystem. That foundation that maintains that ecosystem employs mobile developers from Facebook, Google, Golight, Uptix, you name some companies that use OWASQuery, and they might have a few commits in the core as well. Some of the big companies that still use OWASQuery nowadays are Netflix, Uber, Airbnb, and Facebook, of course, and quite a few others. Now, how does this work? How does OWASQuery actually works? So basically, the operating system is exposed as a relational database with OWASQuery. You can use SQL queries to explore the operating system. You have tables the most of the tables represent the state of different parts. For example, you have the process list, you have running processes. You want to ask the state from a certain process. You do a bit of query. You can also ask what state from kernel modules, which are loaded, which are not loaded. Or another example, the stat command in Linux give you the that moment state of a file, the access time, the creation time, modify time, permissions. You can do the same thing by using a SQL query in OS query. Now, there are two different kinds of tables. You have event-driven tables and tables that purely show state. What I said before, the state tables are tables that show the state of that point, a snapshot of that point of what you're asking for. For example, the files, the processes, or installed extensions, or browser extensions, for example. Now, you have also event-driven tables. Those tables, they have their data that's being pushed by outending APIs. For example, file events. Example, let's say I copy a file to a directory, that's an event. That event will get pushed to the file events table in OS query. There are multiple tables like that. You have file events, you have process events. That, for example, a process just executes a command or moves a file around or something like that. That will then be shown in a process events table. You're basically listening to events on different levels of the operating system. Now, Windows, you can make OS query even more powerful by kind of linking together with Sysmon. But we'll go deeper in that later, because this will be very useful to catch certain elements. Now, I would like to show a few examples of OS query, how it actually works. My first example is around file information. Like I've mentioned before, you can ask the state of a file with a simple SQL query. Now, as you can see on the slides, I have an example for Windows and Linux. The query basically asks for the path, the directory, the file name, the inode, type, and the user ID from a file in a certain directory, and the file name has to start with the word defcon for Windows. Now you can see it finds everything, but no user ID, because the user ID field is only filled in Linux and macOS, but never on Windows. As you can see on Linux, I asked for the same information, just a different part and different file name. And you can see the user ID field is now not zero, but a certain number, which is a user ID that owns the file. Now, this is quite a simple example. Let's go to the next example. This next example is around listening ports. You can, with a simple SQL query, also say, okay, I want to see every process, or I want to see all information of the process that listens on a certain port, of processes that start with a certain name or certain word that is in the name of the process. Now, with this query, I'm looking for the address, the port, and the path of a process that's listening on a certain port, but the process name has to contain the word OS query or Splunk. And you can use even inner joins in OS query. This is a simple inner join based on the field that's the same one on both tables. Now, in Windows, we have the result of there's a Splunk process running, listening on port 8089. Now, on Linux, we see that it finds, again, a Splunk process listening in certain ports. However, it also finds a socket file, because in Linux, you can also, if you query listening ports, you can also see socket files. And OS query use socket file for some communication between processes. So this basically shows you how you can combine two tables to gather information you would like to have. Now, my third example is quite useful to show as well. In Windows and Linux, you can query for pipes, name pipes, anonymous pipes, open pipes. Now, as we all know, in Windows, certain families of malware or command control frameworks, the agents or stages, they use named or anonymous pipes to communicate with maybe sacrificial processes or with some other part of their code or whatsoever. So as an example for Windows, I basically said, give me all information from the table pipes where the name contains my first name, Sebastian, and gives me three pipes. As we can see that the three There are three pipes with my name still in it, still open, still running. And apparently Microsoft Teams has a pipe as well with my first name in. However, I never use Microsoft Teams. This is on Windows 11 preview, so maybe that's why at this moment I should figure out even more. Now, on Linux, there's a small difference between Linux and Windows, because on Linux you can only create open pipes, but you will never have their names. You will have the process ID that it might belong to, the inodes, the modes, the file descriptor, and sometimes all the fields are filled in as well. That's basically it, what you will see in Linux. So there you might have to use some joins together to have some more information. But this example shows you how easy it is to also look very for open pipes, you know, easy it is to gather that information that might be useful in the long run. Now, let's head to the second step, command and control frameworks and their payloads. So in this part, I will go over one or two command and control frameworks and the types of payloads, and afterwards, how you can potentially catch them. Why am I showing these command and control frameworks and payloads? Because I would like to use them as a little bit of an example on how you might be able to catch them with OS query. What are command and control frameworks exactly? They can also be seen as post-exploitation frameworks. They are mostly used by either bad actors or by their teams after they initially exploited the system of the victim that they want to exploit. They need some sort of breachhead. They need something that allows them from outside to get back on the computer without having to exploit the system again. So that's why they sometimes use command and control frameworks. Now, these frameworks, they provide accessible ways for privilege escalation, command execution, pivoting and lateral movement, and so on and so on. They have lots of multiple functionalities. They can also be used on multiple multiple operating systems, Linux, macOS, Windows, you name it. There's probably at least one command and control framework that has some functionality to use on those on that operating system. A few of the more known ones are Empire, Mythic, Cobalt Strike, of course, everyone knows. And you have a few others like Caldera, you have Shadow, and so on and so on. Now, the first one I'd like to talk about is Empire. The Empire C2 framework, it has like a Metasploit-like command line interface. There is also a user interface for it called Starkiller. But in this example, I will only show quickly how the command line interface looks like. It's a little bit like Metasploit. It has auto-completion and quite easy to use. Originally, this was a command control framework with PowerShell for Windows, but more like pure PowerShell. But further down the road, it also gained capabilities for Linux and OS X with Python 3. How can you deploy Empire? You can deploy it using Docker, you can use Kali Linux, or you can do it manually, however you like it. My example, I'll quickly explain how you can deploy it with Docker. So first you pull the Docker image. When that's done, then you can create a persistent storage that even when you shut down the Docker instance, the storage with potentially payloads and stagers is still there. When that's done, you can run basically the Docker image that you pulled in the beginning with the persistent storage, and it will start up the Docker container for Empire. And when it's running perfectly, you can see on the slides what interface will look like. Now, Empire has multiple different stagers. So not really agent stagers. Why just stagers? Because they are quite small. And when you have a stager executed on the target device, then you can send commands to that stager. But those commands include code that will come from your Empire control server, basically. Some of the stagers are shellcode, some are done with dynamically linked libraries, PKG files, macros, you name it. On the screenshot, you can also see the different kinds of stages that Empire has. Most of them are for Windows and Mac OS. So the multi ones, some of them also work on Linux. Now, the second framework I would like to talk about is the MITIC framework. MITIC framework is a cross-platform command control framework. You can basically run it on almost anything, just like Empire, because it it runs in, you can run in a Docker container. It's basically, it's a bit different than Empire. Empire provides already all the stages. With MITIC, it's a plug-and-play architecture. You can say, you can start up MITIC, it won't contain anything, but you can, along the way, add more agents or profiles. How do you deploy it? Again, with just Docker. The web interface, database, the backend, everything runs in a separate Docker container. That's what makes it so modular and plug-and-play architecture. Now, how do you install this one? The first clone, this one repository. Then it has an install script that basically sets up all the containers you need for the database, the queues, listeners, for your web interface, everything. And then you can use its own command line interface to start the entire framework. As a result, you get a nicely pre-built user interface. It's quite easy to use. In my opinion, a bit easier than Empire, but everyone to their own, of course. Now, as I said before, MITIC has a plug-and-play architecture. What I mean with this, so when you install MITIC, you don't have any pre-built agents that are delivered with MITIC. Nowadays, you can find those agents in a separate GitHub repositories where you can install them from. You have agents written in JavaScript for automation, which is for macOS, in Golang, Python, C#.NET. That's quite easy to install. As example, I'm showing you how you can install an agent or a profile. For example, I want to install the Appful agent, which is an agent that is usable for macOS. I just have to use the command line again and provide the GitHub link to the repository of that agent. I can do this and it just works. The same with the profile. I want, of course, a command control profile as well for HTTP or HTTPS or DNS, something else. All different profiles are listed in their own personal GitHub repositories, and you just install them by using the command line again. Now, what's also useful about those agents is that the functionality is already built in. They're not just stagers. They're actually agents. For example, the Appful agent already contains functionality to take a screenshot or to do certain other functionality that's maybe not in all other stages for other frameworks. Or for example, the Apollo agent for MITIC also contains certain functionality to take screenshots or to try to elevate your permissions or to do certain injections, stuff like that. Now, shall we hit the leads? So now I would like to show you how you can potentially use OS query to catch certain things from the from those frameworks or other frameworks. So there are multiple ways to use OS query. There are multiple ways that you can use OS query to catch IOCs, indications of compromise. One is YARA rules, you have file integrity monitoring, you have process events. You can easily combine OS query with Sysmon to catch certain IOCs based on events provided by Sysmon. As I discussed before, I'll show you how you can do this with Sysmon as well, because this creates something quite powerful. And also show you how you can get reverse shell connections with OS query as well. Let's start with YARA rules. What is YARA actually? YARA is a way of identifying malware or other files or even processes with a rule set. The implementation of OS query is with file integrity monitoring. What basically means is I can map a directory to a certain YARA rule set. And then when a file gets moved into a directory or created or copied, it will trigger the YARA rule. That YARA rule will scan that file. And if the rule matches the file, or the file matches the rule, then it will create an event that can be potentially seen as an indicator of compromise. Now, during my investigation for this talk, I found out that specifically the move to file action was not covered by this. this was specifically missing only for the Yara events implementation in OS query. So basically, if in Linux or macOS, you would use the move command, MV command, move around files, it would never trigger a rule because OS query wouldn't see that if you wanted to scan that, those files with Yara. So I made a pull request to the OS query core to fix this so that it would also trigger move to file actions. Now this has been accepted last night and should arrive in the next version of OS query as well for even better protection with Yara rules. Now you could also say, why not move from file actions? Well, move from file actions, that means that you move file away from the directory you're monitoring. So since only one scan files in a directory, it makes the sense to also cover the move from. I will now show you an example of how a Yara rule configuration looks like and what potentially can do and how it looks like as a result. So here, a very, very small rule that basically I've written as an example for this talk. And it basically should detect an Empire Windows shellcode stager for 64-bit systems. I used the GitHub link to the Empire Command and Control framework. And basically it says, if the two strings you see on the screen are seen in the file with Yara, then it will trigger an event because that means that the file matches the Yara rule. The first string is mini empire DLL. That's always in those 64-bit Windows shellcode stagers. And the second is a series of characters that can be seen within hex editor. So if both strings are present in the file, it will trigger a rule and create an event. What does it look like as a result? So as example, I basically copied the stager file to Linux system to show there. And you use directory home shadow, you monitor that with Yara events. And the moment I copy empire_diff.bin file into that directory, the moment I copy it, the Yara implementation in OS query will scan that file. Now, when I scan that file, it will trigger the rule because it matches the strings in the rule. And the result, you can look in a table called Yara_events, and you can see that suddenly in the directory, a file appeared and then was updated that matches that rule. And like that, we have an event. Now, this then can be shown later on with alerting to other people or to your security operations team, because then they see, there's a suspicious file. Maybe we should do something about it. If you don't use Yara rules, you might miss out on certain files from certain command control frameworks. However, most command control frameworks don't have Yara rules defined for them. So you would potentially create them themselves, or maybe someone else can do that. I created these rules to take an example on how you can use the powerful function of Yara to monitor directories and files. The next file I want to talk about, the next function in OS query I want to talk about is file integrity monitoring. How could file integrity monitoring potentially be used to monitor for suspicious files? File integrity monitoring monitors directories for file changes. You can do it on one level or even recursive. It can be used to monitor sensitive directories. For example, on macOS, you have the launched agents directory, launched daemons directory. On Linux, for example, /etc or user lib directory, for example. But this file integrity monitoring also monitors on the move to file action or moved from, not just update, create, or modify, because the implementation of file integrity monitoring with Yara rules is different than actual file integrity monitoring for OS query in general. Now, this is a simple example to show you how you could configure with OS query which directories it should look at. As you can see here, I'm telling my OS query on a MacBook to check different directories, the temp folder, my workspace folder, which contains most of my source code and stuff, and make sure nothing weird happens that I don't know about, or the launch agents, for example. As you can see, the last part states users and then a percentage sign. Basically means I want to, in the users folder, for every other user, I want to monitor the launched agents directory. Now, what does it actually look like if a file enters one of those directories? As you saw the last part in my configuration, I was monitoring for every user the launched agents directory, every single user. So what I did was I used the Mythic framework to generate an Apfel payload. And then I executed that on the MacBook. And then from my command control server, I said, create enable persistence on my victim, on my MacBook. And for persistence, it creates a launch agent that for this time I called com.defcon.surfacer.http.this, which was placed in the launch agent folder for my own personal user. And because I was monitoring that, OS query saw this. So even with this, this event can be reported to, something like Splunk or Elasticsearch, and then maybe a security operations team can look at it and say, hey, there is a suspicious file that appeared here that I don't know about. We should investigate this. Now, the next example is process events. OS query also has the capability to monitor process events. It can monitor process execution. It can monitor execution from parent process or from a child process, and then still see what the parent process is, which can be quite useful. Or for example, it can, for example, monitor for OSJScript on MacBook, for example, or PowerShell execution on Windows or on Linux, let's say on command line execution of Python or something else. Two examples I could come up with was Hidden Lotus and Lame Buyer. Those two mother families from Mac. Why is an example? Because in their complete process tree, both of them use OSJScript to execute certain actions. So if you monitor for unauthorized OSJScript execution, you might have called these two families if you were infected with those two families. Now, what does it look like? Basically, I tell OS query, every 60 seconds, give me all information from process events where the command line contains the word OSA. Because OSA is the first two letters from OSJScript, which is the command to execute OSJScript execution. And when the moment OS query finds something, it will look like the result you see on the screen. Now, as we've seen before, with file integrity monitoring, I execute a malicious payload and then gain persistence. The command line script you see here was the first step. So first I had to download the payload somewhere, which I did with OSJScript and then executed it. And as you see, OS query caught this from me, and all the information can then again be sent to Splunk or Elasticsearch or anything else that will allow you to intervene if necessary, or at least isolate the device and then investigate how far they got before they got to the device. This can also be used to monitor for example, PowerShell execution or Python or weird commands, or for example, normal user wouldn't necessarily decode base64 strings, stuff like that. It can be used quite a lot of things, but you have to be wary that you don't use too much commands at the same time, because you don't want to hog too much resource in the device. Even though which is quite powerful, you can even combine certain queries so you don't have too many queries running at the same time. Another example I would like to show you that's actually quite powerful, but I talked about before, is OS query combined with Sysmon. Now, you're wondering why this is so powerful. So as you all know, Sysmon locks and monitors system activity. It stays active across reboots because it also is device and event driver. Now, what kind of functionality what kind of events can Sysmon monitor for? Process injection, create pipe, and quite a lot of other things. Now, I was talking to a friend earlier, and I told him, yeah, combination of OS query and Sysmon, I can catch process injection. However, it doesn't contain user APC calls. Sometimes post-injection, you use create remote threads as functionality for that. The user APC calls basically abuses already existing threads, which doesn't create new ones, but, and Sysmin cannot see that yet. Now, how would you tie in Sysmin with West Query? Sysmin saves all its events in the Windows event log under the channel Microsoft Security Sysmin /operational. Now, West Query can tap into the Windows events channel and can tap in that specific channel. So every time there's a new event in there, it will also appear in West Query. And West Query can parse that the Sysmin event data and then can create an event out of it and send it to Splunk again to ask search or something else. Now, how to set up Sysmin to work with West Query? Now, there used to be a very good standard config for Sysmin made by Swift on security. But nowadays, someone forked it and approved some pull requests and made it even better. The GitHub repository you can see on the screen. Now, to enable West Query to be able to monitor the channel for Windows events that contain all Sysmin events, you just add the flag to the command line or to a flag file, you restart OS Query, and it can do that. And then, as we've seen before with all those examples, you can, let's say, run a query every 60 seconds that looks at Windows events table, and let's say I want all events that don't have event ID 10. For example, event ID 17 is create pipe, event ID 18 is connect pipe, event ID 23 is DNS event, if I'm not mistaken. This is an example of create pipe. So as most of us know, CobbleStrike. CobbleStrike is used quite a lot by red teaming or for adversarial emulation, but now it is also used by the bad guys because it's quite easy to use and quite powerful as well. CobbleStrike uses pipes, named and unnamed, for communication between the main beacon and sacrificial processes. As an example, there is a pipe with default value msse-number-server that's used to launch shellcode. Now, you would say that's the default value. Yeah, not everyone changes the default values of the names of the pipes. So these rules for Sysmin, or these events in Sysmin, will most of the time still contain the default names. Sometimes people might change the names, but then you have to find another creative way to still catch those pipes. Now, so I basically infected myself with a CobbleStrike beacon, and then from my command and control laptop of my team server, I create a beacon, I execute it on my Windows device, connect back to my control, and as you see, it spawned for me a named pipe called msse-7000-server, as you can see on the screenshots. This gets called by Sysmin, which you see as well, and again, we can send this to Splunk, Elasticsearch, anything you can imagine. Another example that I want to show you that can get called by Sysmin is process injection. For this, I infected another device with the Apollo Mythic agent. It uses process injection to execute certain tasks. For example, in here I said, take a screenshot from me and inject yourself in the process toolbox.exe, which is a tool from JetBrains to maintain multiple IDEs. As a result, as you can see on the screen, again, West Query picked it up and told me technique T1055 and the name is process injection. It tells me what tool was used to use the process injection in. So correction. It tells me also in what process it's trying to inject code and so on. So even these events, we can easily now from West Query send straight to Splunk, Elasticsearch, or something else, and then alert on this again. Now, I really want to like talk about reverse shells as well. Now, reverse shells, they're quite common because sometimes you have bad teams or bad guys who would like connection from a device back to an own server. What are these reverse shells used for? Session established from the victim to the attacker, Sometimes it's illusion when the victim's device is not directly reachable. Maybe it's behind nuts or something else. But if you initially infect the victim, but you can't directly connect to it, you need a reverse shell. So you can open reverse shell and send it straight back. Now, most reverse shells are without D2Y. D2Y basically allow you to enhance the functionality of the shell you have. Reverse shells can be launched in multiple different ways. For example, Netcat, Python, Perl, Bash. Most languages can spawn reverse shell in their own way. I'll show a few examples and after I'll explain to you how we can catch them as well. So these are three examples. Python and Perl look almost the same, just a different language. Almost the same. The Bash is quite more simple. Out of those three, there's only one that will give you a shell with TTY, which is the Bash version. Because you can only, if I'm not mistaken, you can only get TTY if the parent process has TTY as well. So if you want to spawn a reverse shell, only if the parent process has already TTY, you can give enhanced functionality in your shell. Now, let's quickly analyze how, for example, Python would launch in reverse shell. Now, it has no access to TTY because the parent process, Python itself, doesn't have any connection to TTY. It spawns reverse shell port 1111 to IP address 10.0.0.123. And we want all input, output, and errors sent straight to the socket file descriptor, to our reverse shell back at the 1111 servers, not to the victim. So otherwise, the victim might see that something is going on. So it redirects all the STD out, STD and STDR to the file descriptor and close the original ones and then spawns the shell with bin bash. Now, of course, with the web query, you want to be able to catch those things. So this is quite a large query that combines 1, 2, 3 tables, processes, process open sockets, and process open files. With this entire query, we can see if it's potentially a shell running that's where process open files process ID is 0, and that has in the name either sh or bash. Now, because the shell I showed with Python will spawn a reverse shell that will be called by this, I'll show the result, of course. This is the result. We see that it spawns a reverse shell to IP address 51.210 and so on port 1111. And we can see that the command line is bin sh-i. And we can see in the parent command line is the entire reverse shell with Python that we executed. Now, I would like to mention as well, this was a test on macOS. Reverse shells are quite, they depend on the operating system, how they operate, on how, what they're connected to, and how they look like. So you might have to fine tune these queries for other operating systems. In Linux, it might be a little different on Windows again. This is just an example of how you can catch a reverse shell on MacBook or macOS. Now, let's go to the final piece of my talk. Alerting. Now we've seen how command and control frameworks are used, how they work. We've seen how OWASP query works. We've seen multiple ways how we can catch certain elements from frameworks or certain IOCs with OWASP query. Yara rules, file integrity monitoring, Sysmon, you can catch reverse shells if you find the wrong queries, and so on and so on. But we also want to monitor everything and make sure that you can alert it. So alerting should be the next step. So you have an event now that's been detected. What's next? So detection is only a small part. You want to empower your security teams. You want to make sure that they know what's happening so they can intervene as soon as possible. I have two small examples with Splunk Elasticsearch to show you. So this is a small pipeline, alerting pipeline with Splunk. Four elements. So we have on endpoints, OWASP query running, and the other icon you see is the icon of a Splunk forwarder. universal forwarder, which is the most lightweight forwarder they have. OWASPERI basically sends all the scheduled queries it does constantly to a log file. The universal forwarder monitors that file. Every new item it sees, if it has a rule set itself, it will send it to the Splunk instance. Now, the Splunk instance will gather all the data, and in Splunk instance, we can create some alerts. Let's say I want an alert on process injection or create pipe. Then Splunk can send an alert to Slack or PagerDuty. What does it look like, you say? This is a small example on how this might look like. For example, on the you have the OWASPERI output of an event that Sysmon potentially saw possible COBOL strike post-exploitation jobs. How did it saw it? Because it saw a pipe name that looked like a COBOL strike pipe name. Post X underscore and then four random characters. This is the default pipe name that COBOL strike uses for post-exploitation jobs. So OWASPERI, with universal forwarder, sends this data to Splunk. And mid, you can see that there is an alert created, generated on Splunk that will alert in real time if it gets an event that has certain conditions. And to the right, onto the last part, you can see what alert looked like in Slack. So this is from OWASPERI to alert in Splunk that will trigger that will send a message to Slack. And on Slack, the Slack message, you can see potential COBOL strike named pipe detected, where it was detected, which technique, what's technique name, the pipe name, the image, potential file version, if there's any file version, and the link to a specific event of the alert. Now, the next pipeline I would like to show you is ALK stack. Basically, we could say Elastic and Kibana because I don't use Logstash in this sense. Here we use OWASPERI combination with FileBeats. And again, OWASPERI has scheduled queries that puts data in a log file. FileBeat will monitor a log file and sends the data it needs to Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch contains all the data, and the Kibana has alerting functionality that can, for example, send the data to Slack, to PagerDuty, anything else you can imagine. Now, what does this look like? So again, we have an event, and this time I took an event that was triggered on a Yara rule. So again, the Empire DevCon shellcode stager triggers a Yara rule, and we see it was triggered in a home directory, and which Yara rule matched was Empire win shellcode. And you have two strings. Now, it sends that data like a search, and in mid you can see that I created a rule that would trigger on, on these events. Now, that rule, when it sees an event, at least one event or more, it will send an alert to PagerDuty that you can see that then maybe sends a message to my Slack or to my cell phone or anything else to tell me a Yara rule is triggered, maybe this should be investigated. Of course, it can be used, for example, with security operations teams who are on call. For example, they get a message on their phone, they get a phone call that where the system tells them something happened, this alert, please investigate. And you can acknowledge, resolve, or anything else. So we've seen alerting now. We've seen that we have an event on OWASPERI can be sent to Splunk, for example, and to Slack or to PagerDuty to do alerting on certain events that were found by Sysmon, by OWASPERI, apologies. But there is a next step as well. What is next? Maybe SOAR. SOAR stands for Security Orchestration Automation and Response. Now, there are different solutions. For example, you have Phantom by Splunk, you have Cortex XOR by Palo Alto, you have Alien Vault USM, and so on. Now, what is the advantage of SOAR? Actually, basically, they allow you to automate tedious tasks, or tasks that normally your security operations team does. As an example, for example, Phantom with the playbooks. Let's say I have an event that OWASPERI sees a file on a system that triggers the Yara rule. It sends data to Splunk. Splunk sees this, sends alert to Slack. At the same time, also triggers a playbook in Phantom. Now, Phantom can say, oh, interesting. It sees what host is on. Phantom can potentially connect to that host, get out a file, and detonate it on various tools to see what the file actually does, effectively is. And if it sees, oh, this is a bad file, it can maybe react and automatically contain the device the file was found on, or alert security team, this is really dangerous. Its security team didn't have the chance to react yet. SOAR platforms can be used to improve the quality of life for secure operations teams to prevent alert fatigue. Because sometimes secure operation teams get so many alerts that they are they get tired of the alerts and there is a huge backlog. So SOAR platforms can help there to make the backlog smaller and already do certain tasks that secure operations teams don't have the energy for or the capacity for. So I think SOAR platforms are really good use and could potentially help those teams a lot. Now, this was my, what do I have seen in my talk today? So first, I've been doing what is OS Frame and what is it made for? How does it work? What does it do? Afterwards, we've seen how common control frameworks, some of them can be set up, which ones exist, and how the payloads might work. We've also seen how we can catch IOCs created by those frameworks. Then we've quickly seen how reverse shells can be spawned and how we can catch those reverse shells as well. I've also went over how you can set up certain alerting pipelines, how they should work on to alert on certain events that OS Query or Sysmon has seen. In the end, I quickly went over how SOAR platform can improve the quality of life for security operations teams. These are some of the resources I used. I put them here on the slide because I also believe in attribution or credit where credit is due. I would like to thank you all for listening to my talk. I hope you learned something. And if you would like to chat with me, you can find me on the internet somewhere or find me in the speaker channel on Discord as well. Thank you all and see you next time. These are also my contact details if you would like to talk to me.